today so that because of this decision I can grow faster. So they started installing SAP when they could not afford, and they started it at 100 crores. When his company crossed 500 crores, he bought a car, 5,000 crores turnover at the fastest. And to remember that, he also got a number plate matching the numbers. So this is the passion of an entrepreneur that we get to see in this country. His father has been a stalwart. His father has been a historical personality in this country. His father is a person who did the division of the shampoo bottle into shampoo sachets. That is where his maths, being maths professor, helped him. He did the division and multiplied his wealth. So that is how the shampoo sachet was started. He didn't go to Germany or to US or to London and buy an imported machinery which could convert the shampoo bottles into sachets. So he created, with the help of an engineering friend, he created a machine which could make those small sachets. And he was the guy who thought that there should be a one-time use product where you just use it and throw it, and it can become economical even to anybody at the absolute bottom of the society. So that was great thinking. The son has carried on the legacy. I'm sure his children will also carry on the same legacy. And today he is standing here tall in front of us. We are all gathered to understand from him and his wise words of wisdom on how we can apply it to our business model. Mr. Ranganathan, and he's a global player. He's operative in more than 19 countries. I'm sure more than 19 countries. He is having more than 2,400 employees across all the sectors. He is into consumable business also. And at the same time, he is into products which are not to be consumed, like shampoos. There are applications like shampoos and hair color and hair dye. And he's into the food business, he's into the dairy business, he's into multiple businesses at the same time. He's very fond of pets. He lives in a small 3-acre house on the ECR. He has got more than 350 varieties of birds. I think government should make it a tourism point. And his hobbies keeps him peaceful, happy and satisfied. So he lives in ECR. It's almost like a resort type of a house. I don't have the privilege of seeing it till today. I'm sure you'll invite me tomorrow. So this towering personality is going to exchange a lot of details of how he does business over the next 45 minutes to 60 minutes. Mr. Ranganathan, we have got very interesting people in this hall. They know you in detail. Not that I educated them about you. They already knew about you.
A lot of my friends are here.
Yes, but I would like to know those friends, and I would also like to introduce my friends to you. Can we do that?
Yeah, please.
Okay. So the gentleman from JLL, he's a director with JLL who just conducted the session before this. Ramdevan is a stalwart personality of Chennai. Red Bricks, he's into construction. Geeta Chidambaram, Geeta is Nagu's wife. They are industrialists, investments, construction, and they own the famous Kamala Theatre. Mr. Valiappan, a towering personality, the owner of the Kamala Theatre in Chennai. Stalwart, his father has always been a stalwart, Mr. V.N. Chidambaram, the ex-chairman of Meenakshi Madurai. So Mr. Valiappan, the gentleman who is from the journalism sector. Can you please introduce yourself and your sector? Mayajal. Udip from Mayajal. The gentleman is from, again, real estate. They are changing the skylines of Poneri by constructing almost 10 lakh square feet. Mr. Devangsha is a developer from Mumbai, second generation developer. Nagu Chidambaram is, again, Mr. V.N. Chidambaram's son. The owner of Kamala Theatre is into real estate, automobiles. He's an industrialist by business qualification. Milindige is into online. Suwani is into event management. Advocate gentleman was with us on the previous panel. The madam here is? Okay, your good name? From? So just the people whom I don't know, name and the business sector, that's all. Yeah, that is Hemchandran. Everybody knows him. He's into events. The gentleman next to him? Hi. Just the name and the sector. She is the colleague from Knight Frank, and that's her colleague again from Knight Frank. Ajay is a tax consultant. He's come all the way from Bangalore. Yes, sir. Mr. Suhas Deshpande is one of the stalwart architects from India, for India, from Mumbai. He has done the fastest construction in India when he constructed a 32-story building in a place called Shivaji Park, one of the most expensive parts of Mumbai, where a 32-floor building 10 years back was constructed in 22 months. In just 22 months, with lock and key, fully finished. So that's Mr. Suhas Deshpande. in the central part of Mumbai, over a land of 140 acres, I don't know how many lakh crores that property would be. He is the master developer, and his partners are the people who designed the Burj Khalifa in Dubai. That's Mr. Shrikant. He is into the shipping and logistics business. Rohit Rahul is a developer. Sunny is again into construction. He does automated construction in quick construction mechanisms. The gentleman behind, Trishala, she is a college-going girl, and she is also into candle making. Pallavi is into art. They are investors into art and sales of art. Yeah, ma'am. Excellent, excellent. Shailendra Thatte. Shailendra Thatte is an advocate in the copyrights activity, or trademarks and copyright. Lovely. That's Ramu. Ramu is into mergers and acquisitions the world over. He's out of New Jersey, and he's into the pharma sector in a big way. So I think the backdrop is ready. We need to get going on to the conversation. We'll get onto the stage, please. So, Mr. Ranganathan, this is a very interesting times, and when you began business, the scenario was different. In 2003, in 1993, when the policies changed, the scenario was different, and today the scenario is different. How do you see your business growing in the current scenario as an entrepreneur?
Thank you, Mr. Rajesh, first of all, for this opportunity. I also would like to take this opportunity to thank Hamachandran. Thank you, and Network 18, all. Currently, I think last year we had a demonetization and such kind of hurdles. But despite that, I must say that we are growing very well in terms of growth is not an issue. Even last year was not an issue also. So we have been doing better than the industry is what I must say, that we are growing at about 20% growth rate.
Fantastic. Your expansion plans are global. You are already in more than 19 countries. Yeah, how do you take it forward, and how do you take it faster?
I think we have a global team who will go and appoint distributors in different countries. And that's the first way that we go and seed the countries. So once we know that the product starts picking up, and we take special care in countries which are high potential, we do marketing, and then eventually also start doing our own distribution.
How can you speed up the process if you want to reach faster? Because we have got more than 200 countries, and you want to become same or bigger than an HUL or a Procter & Gamble. How do you do that?
Yeah, that's correct. It is the best way to speed up the process is you have to have a structure by which you have people across the continents. So you create an office and structure where you can sustain and build across the country. So Africa, that means Africa itself, East Africa, South Africa, like that you can split and appoint country managers and link up to that as a structure whom they report to, kind of this thing. So North America, US, and all kind of these things. You have to have country managers through which the kind of this thing.
As an entrepreneur, you're a student of chemistry. You're in a similar line of business. What is your strong point? Are you good in product creation, product identification, demand and market supply, distribution network, finance management? What has been your strength?
People management.
And how do you identify those people?
People identification, I think it comes over a period of time. One of the important thing is we recruit people for attitudes. That's a very important thing. If you ask me what's the reason for our success, it is the culmination of collective attitude of a strong team. So we know which are the attitudes that are responsible for success of a particular function to be successful. So for sales, there is some set of attitudes are very important. Marketing, certain things. R&D is slightly different. Like that, we have very clearly identified which are the attitudes they need to bring it to the table so that they can definitely deliver the required.
So how does your team recruit, train, retrain and retain people, valuable people? How do you do that? What is your strategy for that?
So when we look at recruitment, normally we used to do the same mistake. We normally do mistakes and learn. That's kind of this thing. So we did a lot of mistakes in recruitment. Going behind, okay, very good CV, worked in so-and-so companies and such kind of things. Eventually, after hiring, we find after 3 years, 4 years, oh, not up to the mark kind of thing, they're leaving kind of thing. So then we said, okay, we will have certain protocols that will help us in terms of recruiting very strong candidates. So fundamentally, we looked at people who just hasn't worked in a company more than about 1 year, 2 years, like that, they just keep shifting. So we said we will not recruit people who just keep shifting from more often within 2 years, 2.5 years, like that. So because what is the problem is, we assumed, we may be wrong, but we said, if we say, if somebody is leaving within 2.5 years time, that means they are not got promoted, but they are just kind of thing, they have been asked to go.
How are you different from the other employers? How are you different? How do you retain them?
No.
There has to be some magnet.
Yeah, I will just answer this. So we said we will recruit someone who got internally recognized and promoted in a company. So one promotion, two promotion, three promotions, the more longevity in a company is a very strong candidate for us. So instead of paying 10%, 20% premium, say we said we will go up to even 40% premium also. It's not an issue. So the company should feel that I am losing a very good candidate. So that's the kind of thing that is very important for us.
So how do you poach good people from your competition?
So it's very important. Look at candidates who got multiple promotion within short span of time. They are stalwarts. Very simple. So which is one of the important things.
Initially, when you started your business, you struggled to get your first 25,000 rupees loan from the bank. It took you 3 years. Later on, those banks started giving you more and more money. What is your financial management strategy as on date?
So our financial management strategy is get things on credit, sell on cash. This is what we have been following today, yesterday, even when I started. Otherwise, I wouldn't have been successful. Because when I started small, we didn't have a brand name at all. So we have to identify people who will be able to give me cash. So somebody who is even not able to say the kind of thing, we went to bicycle hirers. So they were wanting to just shift, looking at other dignified business in the society from bicycle hiring. So we said, okay, give us 2,000 demand draft that you can be an FMCG distributor. The deal is that we'll teach you how to do the business.
Fantastic. In your last almost 3.5 decades of doing business, you changed the name of the company thrice. What's the reason for that?
So as we go forward, first it was Chik India. Then we later named it as Beauty Cosmetics. Chik India was a partnership company. When we wanted to make it a private limited company, then made it Beauty Cosmetics Private Limited. We wanted to go beyond shampoos and cosmetic products. So we are today in milkshakes, pickles and so on. So if I introduce pickle in beauty cosmetics, people think, what is that beauty cosmetics and pickle to do? So we wanted to have a neutral name. So that's how we came with this thing of CavinKare.
You have got private equity investments in your enterprise currently?
No.
You exited them. So when you got them invested on board, what was your pitch to them?
My pitch was that we will grow well. So that was a pitch that we offered them, that they also will get a very good return on investment. Very important. Anybody would look at whether the company will grow and what is the kind of return they will get. We guaranteed them some minimum level of return. And of course, we asked for a 5-year time. We delivered it in 4 years.
And what is the next step of finance management? Will you go onto a bigger platform to raise funds, or how are you going to take your next growth?
I think probably the next way out for us is to going public.
So generally, when companies raise money from private equity, the general exit for them is at the IPO level. So you pre-exited them. Was there a specific reason for that?
I think it was convenient to them as well as to us. We had cash. So then when they also were looking at an option to exit, we said, fine, we'll offer them the kind of thing.
You have acquired a couple of clients, especially in the food sector and the other sectors. How good are you at acquisition? How do you make a decision? How do you make a judgment? And how do you calculate on that?
I won't say we are very good in terms of...
All those who got bought over said we are very good in acquisition.
Of course, we pay a good price. So that's why they will say that.
There might be a difference of opinion from their side for this. Do you feel that acquisition is best way of growth, quick growth?
Of course, yes. It's a very good way of quick growth. My friend Sudhakar is here. Sudhakar from Devayani Exports, construction. real estates, and he's the one who roped me into dairy sector.
So he made you buy that factory?
Yeah, absolutely.
You bought the factory for real estate and then you plan to continue with the business. The machinery there motivated you to do that?
Yeah, no, actually he gave me a carrot that it's a real estate value, therefore you can buy and do the business. So we said, okay, anyway there is a real estate value which is basic there. We wanted to get into dairy, okay, why not? That's how we started.
Subsequently, you also got into juices.
You are right.
And juices is also an expanding business model for you today.
So now we have clubbed juice and dairy into one plant, so that we make both in the same plant. It makes our life easier.
Subsequently, you also ventured into restaurant business.
That we closed, because we need not have to succeed in all the businesses we enter in.
So what has been your successful failure?
Repeat.
What has been your best successful failure?
So restaurant is one. We got very early into mineral waters. We failed. So these are things, those are the things I would say.
There was a patch of time in India, there already is a patch of time in India where every entrepreneur wanted to become a developer. Any inclinations towards that as well?
No, I never got tempted.
Your pets kept you busy.
No, not like that. I think one of the, this thing is real estate sector is completely, I wanted to deal with, it's a project based thing. So it will take slightly, you need to move on one sector to another and build a brand image and this thing. Plus we didn't know the domain at all. We're very good at, we want to use always our distribution network. So we have a distribution network is a big asset. Whether I sell shampoos or dairy products or pickles, everything can go into the same salesman can go and give to the same shop. Here I have to completely create a new this thing, which I don't want.
So you don't want to do that. Day before yesterday, I met a very dear friend, thanks to my friend Vivek Mendonca, the gentleman who was the creator of Old Spice, Eric Menezes. And when I told him about you, he said that he is my guru for sales, distribution and supply chain management. What is that different that you do compared to the others? And such a successful man saying this is a big deal.
And I must thank him for giving liberal compliments. So, what we do differently is we go to small villages and have our representation there, small distributors. Across the country, we have close to 3,000 salesmen who sell our product every day. So they are all digitally wired, they have smartphones, they will take order only in the phones, and immediately the order will get synced into the central server. So we know very clearly across these 3,000 salesmen will take every day, for example, 50 outlets they will take orders. So that's the kind of thing that we get into. That is 15,000 outlets order will be taken in this thing, not 1.5 lakh this thing.
You have got a great rural penetration, especially for your shampoo sachets. Mm-hmm. What is the secret behind it? Because it has reached even villages which don't have proper water.
So, one of the success secrets for that is we are the pioneers in terms of taking them. We went in vans and demonstrated how to use a shampoo. So we used to call, with a mic we used to call and demonstrate this is how shampoo to be used. And soap, what is harmful about soap if you use it on the hair. And we demonstrate that and we make it available in the outlet nearby. We immediately give a lot of free samples to the people who come and see the kind of demonstrations. After that, within about next 4-5 days later, it will start moving from the outlet. So this is how we used to market every nook and corner of villages. We went about doing it. And we also
so immediately... So you did road shows?
As we do, yeah, a lot of road shows. Immediately appointing a stockist in the village, local village, and he will take stocks. We'll distribute in the outlets there. And that's done. So we have to go one village to another. The van which starts here, it will go on a continuous tour for 15 days. Then it will come back, refill the stocks and go about doing it.
In your 3.5 decades of experience, which has been your most successful sales strategy?
I must say that going to these kind of rural and developing the market, sampling and developing it kind of thing, this was a very, very difficult one at that time. Shampoos were used to be available only in bottles. And these small outlets never used to have shampoos. So the multinationals are all thought that shampoos will be sold only in bottles and big outlets. So they never recognized the small outlets. It's almost, we got a run of about 10 years, one decade. They never recognized the kind of this thing. By the time they wake up, I think we have already come to a size And it was easy for us to, from there onwards, to fight them when even they come.
So you taught your competition of the sachet business. What did the competition teach you?
They taught us quite a lot in terms of technology. So how it is important to give technology so that you can fight them head on. But without technology, you go and fight, because they have fantastic technology worldwide. So that kind of a thing, that means because of that, we invested heavily in our own R&D. That R&D investment, but for that, I think in 2004, we had a very big investments in our R&D.
4 crores.
No. That is about 25 crores of investment at that time. So it's no looking back. Because of that, today I can say that we are able to file so many patents, we are able to really take them head on in terms of quality. So our philosophy is very simple in terms of product philosophy. Either we launch a differentiated product or significantly winning product over competition. It cannot be equal product. So that we are very, very clear. Our salesman, when he go and meets the kind of outlets, the shop owner should welcome. Come on, your product is most wanted. So these are two things that anybody who thinks in our R&D that I will develop an equal product, they will not have a place.
You are into retail business, which is all about sales, sales and sales in a very thickly competitive environment. High competition, price war, all of that. How do you sustain yourself in such an economy? What are the strategies that you adapt to make sure that your percentage on revenues used for advertising and marketing is in the right proportion? How do you determine the percentage on your sales revenue to be spent for the advertising and marketing for further growth?
No, it is not the percentage we determine. We look at what is this product requires to succeed. What kind of advertisement support required?
How do you create your advertising budget?
Sometime it happens. When we introduce a product, it will be 250% of the sales. So it need not be percentage of 250%, 300%, 400% of sales.
Is there a cap on your advertising expenditure?
No, we know that. For example, All India, if you are to launch a product, we have to be ready with the 50 crore budget for advertisement alone. So if you don't have that kind of a budget, we should not be thinking of All India. For one Tamil Nadu, if you are to look at that kind of thing, we need to have at least about 7-8 crores of ad budgets with a product, any product, one state in south. So that is a bare minimum we have to have in our packet to get into launching a product.
Do you
do
product?
That product may give us an yearly turnover of only 3 crores. Sometime it may give 30 crores. So it depends on that. That's priority. We'll take a call.
How do you do your return on investment on a particular product for your advertising spend?
Normally, we choose products which will start giving us payback within about 12 months of launch. And that's what we choose. Sometime we take products which will take about 2 to 3 years time. So we don't go beyond that. But whereas some companies will take even 7-8 years of this thing, a payback period of 7 or 8 years, by the time it breaks even. So that we don't do. Because we are in a hurry. So we will always look at faster payback.
What is your learning curve for the development of new products? How do you learn, or how do you make a judgment or a decision on launching new products?
So very simple. I told you, either it has to be a significantly better product or a differentiated product. Otherwise, we don't launch. So somebody says, okay, I have also a shampoo. This is equal, good performance like the product. He said, no, it doesn't stand a chance. We go to customers, we test it. The customer should say that this is a much better product than what they use. Benchmark competition. So only then we will launch it.
For a sachet product, you started selling it in around 1998-1999 at 50 paise per sachet. And you continued it for a long, long period of time. And still you increase
today.
Your gross profit.
Even today.
Even today. And you still increase your gross profit. Credit goes to technology and volume, scale of operations. What is it?
I think it's credit goes to the team who continue to think that it is possible to squeeze the juice out of the squeezed lemon every time. So they come out continuously, they say how to cut costs without compromising on the quality. So that I think is a very important thing. It's the belief of the team who drive it, who make it happen.
Every company which has grown fantastically with great speed has always been dependent on technology. How have you used technology to your advantage?
So as I told you, the kind of distribution, it's completely wired, which is very important thing. So that every till 11 o'clock, or every 1 hour or half an hour, we know what is All India sales, that's for the day. What, which product, every brand manager will look at, okay, what's my product sales today or this, as of this hour, which is a very important thing. Sales is kind of, then we also look at technology, use technology in terms of inventory management. So it's okay, what is the stock, it is there, what is getting sold, it's getting produced in the factory. So that is also another important thing, technological usage.
Have you faced challenges in supplying materials across the inventory management across the country? Have you faced challenges and how have you overcome those challenges?
So because earlier it was planning, we'll plan, forecast next 3 months stocks, what is the sales, therefore you produce, you make order and do that. Now we all stopped it because that doesn't work. Every time you plan, your estimation need not come true at all. So the best way we have come to is that whatever is sold is what will get produced in the factory. So the pipeline will automatically get coming quickly. So that way our fill rate, that is whatever order generated, we are successfully able to give to the market about 98% to 99% of whatever order generated by the sales team. So which is very important. Never in the forecast levels we are able to achieve this kind of a thing.
Every entrepreneur is bases his decisions on the information that he gets from his field force and his team. What is the kind of information that influences your decisions?
Our information is generally, if you look at how the brands, we don't look at knee-jerk reaction of daily basis, we look at the data. But we look at the trend for the last 12 weeks, 16 weeks, so 26 weeks like that. Then we look at the pattern as to how this is growing. The moment there is a brand which is stagnating or there is a slight dip, we'll act upon. Week on week itself, we'll know it's not going at that kind of thing. Quickly, we'll swing into action. So that is a very important thing. We look at the trend of the kind of each brand, each state, whether the distribution is increase or any everything, we'll look at that. That will give us a very clear idea as to where to kind of this thing tighten the screws.
In a product industry, there are three methods of growth. One is adding more customers to your existing product line, adding more customers. Second is adding more products to your existing customer base. And third is using both, adding more customers and adding more products. What has worked better for you both in these three methods?
The third one.
Is it a convenient answer or it is actually that way?
So actually, because if you look at, we launch minimum 4 products in a year. So that is very important for us. And for that launching 4 products, we minimum have about 8 products in the pipeline. So this is very fundamental. And every year we increase, for example, currently we reach 1 million outlet directly. Indirectly we reach close to about 3.5 million outlets. So every year we will increase it by 20% new outlets. So that means new customers of retail outlets we'll bring in. By advertisement, we'll also ensure that in the same outlet we sell more. That means more customers comes in, by same customer consume more. These are very, very important for us. So we also measure per capita consumption, how it is going. So all combination of that, we will be able to do that. Because otherwise, depending only on just selling it to more customers alone would not help. The same customer should buy also, increase more. That is also, okay, they should consume more.
So the customer first uses shampoo for his hair, then applies oil, and then comes for a haircut to your unisex salons.
Yeah, absolutely right. So
what is the further forward integration of your business?
After so many rounds of shampooing, when they get graying, we'll also have colors for them.
What is the further forward business integration that you'll do?
Forward integration, if you look at hereafter, it's only putting up a retail store, which we thought of that and said no. Why? We don't want to, because we are going to the retail, we don't want to compete again with retail outlets. They will suddenly they will feel that these guys are having another outlet next to my outlet and they are competing with me, why should I kind of this thing. So we don't want to get into a conflicting role.
Like me, you also must be loving the size of the population of our country, because that's more customers to both of us.
Absolutely right.
How do you take advantage of such a large population by multiplying your turnover? How can you reach to them faster and in a bigger net? How do you do that?
So it's two ways we do that. Because the India, I think we see always two India, the little India and the greater India. The metros are all greater India and the little India is the kind of this thing and completely different in behavior. So for example, the metro markets, we'll have products which are kind of thing, for example, milkshakes. We have a milkshake tetra pack at 25 rupees. So that is a kind of thing that we give in any milkshake somebody wants. Same thing, if you have to take a common man, go to the rural, we have a 5 rupee sachet of fruit drink at 5 bucks. Because they can't afford 25 rupees drinks. Both will serve the same one level of this thing, one quench of thirst. It will be one kind of this thing, it will be sufficient. So it is 5 rupees to 25 rupees. We swing that kind of a thing to the customer.
I think this is one of the greatest learning that you took from your dad.
Yeah, actually he...
Of that one time you thought?
You are absolutely right. There is a fortune at the bottom of the pyramid. That's what he taught us.
And definitely, the bottom of the pyramid for us is too wide.
Yeah,
one of the widest.
That's correct.
So you're taking advantage for that
absolutely.
As well. When you talk about products, these are all products which will always have a customer feedback. So if I use a shampoo, I'll have a feedback. If I use oil, I have a feedback. If I use a color dye, I'll have a feedback. What is your customer feedback mechanism? And how do you use it to better your product?
So our customer feedback mechanism is our team goes to the customer and meets them directly. So there is a clear norm for marketing person has to meet so many customers directly, engage with them, go to their house, stay with them, and such kind of things. Similarly, our scientists also have to meet and understand the customers. So on a net-net basis, our R&D personnel will talk marketing language. And that's a very important thing because customer meeting is a very important thing that where from we are kind of thing. Otherwise, we will not be able to.
How many members are there in your core team and how do you motivate them?
Core team, we have about 31 members. So they are the kind of these things. And I think the motivation comes from if you look at there is a kind of profit share is one of the ways that we motivate them. So every year company profits, increased profits. So that we share with them. There is a 13% of the increased profit every year, additional profit they make over the last base. It will be shared with the team in addition to the performance incentives.
What is the method of your vendor management?
Pay them on time. Whatever credit time, we will try to get maximum credit, but pay them on time. That's a very important thing for us.
Do you keep watching their quality when they give you credit period?
Yeah, we test for quality and then only we make this thing acceptance of the product.
Fantastic. Friends, this is all for you now. We can ask questions and I'm sure you'll have a lot of questions. He's a very interesting person.
Thank you. Thanks.
So if we can encourage questions from the audience. Yes. Can somebody go around with the mic quickly because we need to get the questions recorded.
My name is Chodan Nachiyar, President Tamil Chamber of Commerce. 75 years old organization. This is regarding about your company name. Is it CavinKare? Is it?
CavinKare.
That is, according to me, I thought it was Kavin means Aragu, Care means Akkarai, Aragum Akkarayum. I thought that is the meaning, maybe. But according to you, what is that mean for your company's name? Is it any purpose?
Whatever you mean is the same meaning for me also.
You accept that, huh? Being a Tamil chamber, I want to know whether you purposefully put this because you are a global organization now. So instead of putting the direct Tamil name, something which is not understandable, CavinKare is different.
It's not CavinKare. We don't pronounce it CavinKare.
No.
We don't. It's CavinKare. It's not CavinKare.
But
so actually, we were earlier known as Beauty Cosmetics. When you want to change over to a neutral name,
okay.
Beauty equivalent word in Tamil is Kavin. Kavin Migu Solai.
That is why I told that is Aragum Akkarayum. So that is, you take care of your customer
absolutely.
And your products are beauty.
Absolutely. Care, we spelt it as K-A-R-E so that my initial C-K comes.
Okay.
And
the secret of is that.
Yeah,
okay.
Initials with your dad's name.
Absolutely.
Thanks, Chennikrishnan.
Chennikrishnan. Yeah,
Chennikrishnan. Yes. Yeah, gentlemen.
Hi. I'm Varun, practicing chartered accountant. What is your best advice for startups since you yourself are a startup about 3.5 decades back?
So when you want to, best advice is that without experience you jump. That's what I would say. Because too much experience you may get confused. You may not start quite a lot of time. I can just tell a small example. My son who just started, graduation post that he's just started immediately within a month or so. He's just 22 years old. 2 years ago, he started a small bakery and one outlet he said he opened and he made it a successful thing. It is called CK's Bakery. So today, it's the coming June 8th, it will be 2 years. That is how he has started. No experience. I have no experience of bakery to coach him. He has started on his own. He learned the hard way about calculations, gross margin, people management, everything. Today, he is successfully running 52 outlets and over 300 people he is managing. And very fantastic, profitably fantastic. Running, very profitably running. And this is what I can say. I have also done the same thing. It is possible. You don't need to kind of, all it requires is guts and willingness to learn. If you say that I am not afraid of failing, I will learn, then you will be succeeding. I must say, all the time I enjoyed traveling. I won't say this is a particular time. It is very important you need to enjoy. And very important thing is that whenever challenges came in, that was the best time that I get the best out of me. There are two ways you can deal with the problem. You can run away from a problem, but you can plunge into the problem. So I prefer the latter. So I always get into the problem deep and deep dive and say how it can be solved. That's a very important
fantastic thing. Fantastic. Rohit, we need to ask questions quick.
Patanjali Group is, you know, making insane growth. So the big companies are feeling the heat and feeling the threat. So do you feel the same way, or how do you want to safeguard your business?
I think, first of all, salutes to Babaji. I think he has been doing a fantastic job. And he has also launched shampoos. Fortunately, I think last year, if you look at all the leading competition, I've grown at 2-3% in shampoo categories, 3%, 4%, that's the level of this thing. And we have grown over 17% last year in shampoos.
Fantastic.
And that's where Babaji also playing. I think nowhere we were affected. We are growing very well, and we are doing exceedingly well in shampoos.
So Babaji is good for you.
Absolutely. I feel that we are not affected.
Makran.
One of the thing which you mentioned while selecting an employee, you look at right attitude. How do you ensure that there is a right attitude mix at a board level?
Board level. So same way, when you alter board level, if you are kind of this thing, you are going to hire an outside director at a board level, you have to definitely identify the pedigree, where he did, what he did, and kind of this thing. That thorough homework one need to do. So that will make a big difference. Because based on the success, the skill set, what is required for the board, and what that gentleman has done, or the kind of lady has done, if it matches, you have to bring in. Otherwise, just go by the kind of name, big names may not be. You have to look at whether it is suitable and what is required is met.
Next question. Yes, Amol.
Good evening, sir. I want to ask you, how did you establish brands at a very initial stage when the company was small and when you had very low budgets for it? Because today you may have very high budgets, but What were the inexpensive, smaller, but important strategies that, you know, helped you establishing your brands?
Yeah, I think if you notice one very important thing, we always believed any success starts from the product. So always very important thing that makes your advertisement relatively lesser. When you are small, when you don't have a budget, I think it's important your advertisement is your product. So what I said is it has to be significantly better than competition. With whom I'm going to fight. This is one first important qualification. Or it's a differentiated product. If differentiated product, I will go and say that this is how I am different, people will be willing to try. Or I need to say, when they try it, whoa, this is a better product than what I'm using. Then your advertisement money, the word of mouth will spread when the quality is good. When the quality is equal, you need to have deep pockets to spend. A startup, majority of the startup fail because they give equal product. Are slightly better where the consumer, they will say my product is better. Consumer should say, it is not you should say it is better. They should say it's a much better product. So when I say better product, significantly better product than competition, it is customer's voice, not our voice.
Good evening, sir. Sir, you are competing with all the international brands. And the way you are explaining looks like you are a winner. Tell us about this competition, sir. Very important. Because this competition is very, very intense in the field that you are in. Please.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there are global organizations, multinationals across every country across the world, they are available, both P&G and Levers. So they are the largest, two largest organizations in the world in the FMCG sector. What is very important is they, for example, PNG has over 7,000 scientists worldwide in their R&D kind of thing. We have 60 scientists. So very, very important thing. But how come 7,060 kind of this thing is that we have our own kind of this thing in terms of, if we focus very clearly that we will offer a kind of very significantly better product, what kind of technological equipments and other things we have, that will make a big difference. So that is how we are kind of making a difference in terms of based on our innovations. So what we look at is generally, we look at where the people are there, we will not think the same way. For example, hair color. There are a lot of hair colors are there in the marketplace. We wanted to get into hair color. So one of the ideas our marketing and R&D team, when they met the customer, is somebody applies the hair color, they have to wait for about 45 minutes for the products to color. Now, why not if we color it in 10 minutes? Is it possible? Then immediate response is, how is it possible? It will take 45 minutes. R&D person said, why not? We will try. So we worked out, we came with the product of 10 minutes hair color. So that became a big hit for us, if you look at. So that is a very important. Then you are competing, same, I am competing with L'Oreal, but their platform is all 45 minutes. I am competing with 10 minutes, easy acceptance, same or better delivery than them, better longevity. Quite naturally, customer will prefer me.
You had any acquisition attempts on you?
Every day.
By the large, by the large guys.
Every day, because people are very much interested. If you say yes, they'll be kind of thing. It is a very kind of very important thing for them.
Yeah, Ramdevan.
You've been very successful, and in a very short period of time, success has come to you faster than most other players in most businesses. I'm sure you would have had your cash challenges, managing your cash flow as you went along. I'm sure money would have chased you because you were successful. What was the driver for choosing debt or equity or investors or whatever it is? What was your favorite choice? How did you go about making those decisions?
Debt over equity, that's
equity or any of the other investment opportunities that people would have chased you with. Because you were successful, money would have followed you.
Yeah, one very important mantra we said is a lot of people are ready to give loan. Every day bankers will knock. So only thing what we said is, if you don't require money, we will not take. Very fundamental. So because there are a lot of temptation, people will come and say, I will give at a lower rate. So for that, if you start thinking, oh, low rate of interest, somebody is getting giving loan, therefore I can buy something, you are getting buying problems. So that is very important things that we always avoided. So other thing what we happened is, when we have borrowed money and we don't keep on stretching ourselves, we definitely come to a balance, to some level where we have a control of reduction of the debt, then only we will go about kind of thing. We will not compromise on our growth, but we will not keep on borrowing too much and okay, that acquisition is coming, here we will go and acquire. You keep going recklessly, you will be betting your base, which we don't do. That's a very important thing.
Fantastic, yes.
Sir, if you were to look at the next investment in manufacturing, which state would you evaluate in terms of investment attractiveness?
I think next big state of investment would be UP, Bihar. These are large population bases. So those kind of states are very, very big. We are already there in southern states, Maharashtra, Gujarat, all those things. UP also, we are largest, we are quite comfortably there. The more investment, more this thing can come in, because the population size is very, very large. And the current chief minister of UP, the way they are driving the kind of state for forward path, I think the opportunity will be much, much better, is my viewpoint. UP will be the one I will bet big.
Sushant.
Good evening, sir. My name is Sushant Rao Rane. My company's name is Adroit Biomed, and we operate in a similar segment, that is, you are into FMCG, and we follow a pharmaceutical business model with focus on dermatology and cosmetology. Now, from the discussion that we had, what I've learned is you have laid on two important growth levers. One is product, and second is distribution. Now, my question is pertaining to the product part. Now, in product, you have always tried to work on the bottom of the pyramid and offer a product which is a mass base. So, while selection of this product, do you believe in going for a futuristic product and make it so common that even a common man can use it on day-to-day basis? So, is this a product selection criteria that you're following, or what is it?
I think there is no one single formula like that, because we also master ourselves in terms of bottom of the pyramid is separate segment. Some brands belong to bottom of the pyramid. Some brands belong to a higher kind of this thing, strata. So it depends on which brand team, what is the marketing team thinks that this is what we need to do, we take up the kind of this thing. It is depends on the consumer insights what we get. So the milkshake is one, I don't know whether you have tasted our milkshake. Milkshake is one of the unique products we have. Again, not very different from what is there available in the marketplace. Okay. And that is also comes out, that is what I said, no, unique products. When we want to get into the market, it has to be different. So that's why when we launch the product, any supermarket it is there, we will be holding majority of the market shares. 50%, 60% of the milk drinks will be ours. Amul will be around 12%, 13% only. Before we go in, Amul will be 70-80%. But the moment we launch, within 2-3 months time, we will have a big market share in that. So it's all because of differentiated product. When the consumer tastes, they know that this is a very good product.
And your size is also a differentiator.
Yeah, absolutely. So what I mean to say is that eventually we will look at both bottom of the pyramid as well as the kind of this thing, higher affordable classes. We have a perfume. Okay. So all those things, if you look at perfume bottles and all, it is catering to a particular segment of people. Right. Depends on what kind of a thing we do.
So normally in product innovation, when you innovate a product, you actually, you know, you spent a lot. So that's where you need to milk the product. So do you start with the same product first, getting targeted to the premium segment and then take it to the masstige?
No, it all depends on the brand name.
On the brand.
So some of the categories, if you look at our turnover, for example, today, about 45% of the turnover is uncontested. That means no competition for us. Okay, very important. When I say that, how I am different, 45% of the turnover is no competition. Balance 55 only, I have a direct competition.
Wow.
So that's how we are consciously putting such kind of efforts. Our R&D is meant to come out with differentiated products. We incentivize scientists and marketing team who come out with differentiated products. Those who are kind of doing significantly winning products are incentivized lesser. So that is our future bet is always how different we are.
Thank you very much, sir.
The gentleman behind, and after that, Nagu. Last three questions.
Good evening, sir. My name is Vineet Bansode. I'm a graphologist by profession. I read people through their handwriting and signatures. What is your take on the assessment test that we do for the employees for retention? Do they work, or have you tried anything something like that?
Do they work for?
For your organization, or do you practice that kind of this thing, you know, test, assessment test?
What is the format of your assessment test for employing people?
So we actually, employing, we do our own interview techniques. We do that based on attitudes.
Okay.
And depends on the kind of, we have given a set of attitude for each position.
Right.
So that we have also, we have engaged in a psychiatrist. So every candidate,
test. We
pay 3,000 rupees for the psychiatrist for assessing.
Okay.
It's a detailed psychometric analysis test, not a psychometric tool.
Okay.
It's a person who interviews them.
Right.
For about 2.5 to 3 hours time, based on each attitude you need to validate, he will give us a report. Based on that, we'll select a candidate. That's a very important kind of thing.
Good.
That is when we onboard a candidate.
Right.
When we promote also, we'll look at whether new level, this is the kind of attitude required, whether the candidates during the, because normally what happens, the boss concerned will say, he's very good, he can be promoted.
True.
So a lot of time what happens, we don't know whether he'll be promoted, or sometime it's a bias. Is good, so
yes.
some we have to give kind
exactly.
of thing. So we eliminate it by doing the same kind of psychometric test and suitability on the attitude part, what is required at that level.
Perfect.
Nagu, I'll come
Thank
to you after this question.
Done.
He's talking for a long time. Yeah.
Good evening. This is Magesh. I'm an entrepreneur. I started a company called luxpick.com, primarily into the rental of luxury fashion. So we door deliver and return pickup through e-commerce segment. So I've been inspired that you're this thing basically on, you know, you're into various sector, including the fashion like green trends. I have a question, you know, this is like as a general South Indian, typically as a South Indian, all of us are, you know, very good in doing something what we know. And we are happy with, you know, to some extent it grows and then we stay there. We never attempted to premiumize the product that we already generate. We never attempted, as a South Indian I'm talking about, you know, most of the companies we cannot say, is there any single brand which can be highly premiumized, irrespective of the product quality or whatever they call it, and people are waiting to buy it. Is there something that as a South Indian companies we are missing in that? Because today the entire country with 1.4 population billion, a lot of money in terms of wallet share is going up, people are earning capacity is going up. There must be something way that, you know, we can make more money in shorter time by offering a premiumized products. It is nothing to question on the quality of it. I mean, quality is anyway best, South Indians are giving the best quality. Is there, or ambitions are getting blocked, is my question.
Yeah, I think what you said is right. there is something, we are actually very contented people. In Tamil it said, Poduman Ramaname Pun Seyum Marundu. So that's how we have been groomed from the younger age onwards. So be contented with life, contented with what you have. Don't aim big. Don't try to fly high. These are daydream. These are the kind of things that we have been told very often. And you grow with that kind of a mindset. Therefore, you are very cautious when it comes to the kind of thing, taking any steps. Whereas in business, what is very important is you have to dream big. You have to daydream. So you should not dare to dream big. That's a very, very important thing. So that way, what happens is when you dream big, your passion to grow will be higher. When you want to grow big and passion is also very high, automatically premiumization, whatever is required, it will all follow through. So very important thing is, I think beyond a level, satisfaction level quickly comes in because it's put into our mind right from young age onwards, which is what I think we need to all fight it against.
Nagu, last question. Nagu.
He wants to ask one question and then I'll take it.
Oh, okay. Last two questions, yes.
Hi, good evening. I actually have two questions. One is, in regards to your shampoo business, do you think the future is, there's powder-based shampoo where water is not required? Is that the future? And two, do you have plans for an IPO?
So I will talk about we have plans for IPO, not immediate, but maybe in a couple of years we have to be out in the market. So that's one we feel. Because I won't be doing justice by remaining private. I don't want to be contented. I have to fuel the growth ambition. So that's one. The second is shampoo, powder-based shampoo. I'm not sure that we will be, as human beings, will be easily satisfied. The water gives a kind of freshness to us. Without water, just applying it, you feel clean. I'm not sure how many of us will so easily convert into that mode. So to me, that is far, far away. So not easy at all.
Powder base might be for the people who don't have hair. Yes, no, Nagu.
The rejuvenation, what you get when you bath in water, the kind of freshness feel kind of thing. You don't bath and just get into not one hour touching water. You don't get that kind of a thing at all.
Yeah, Nagu.
Sigar, you've been pretty frank. You've been very honest like always you have been.
Thanks,
quick question.
Nagu. Thanks.
Every product you launch is a risk that you take. And you've been continuously taking risks, informed risks, you've made mistakes, all that. But how do you mitigate risks? You're of a given size. You cannot slip too much. It's a different story if you slip. People want you to slip. But how do you mitigate if something like that happened?
I don't bet the full house. Very important thing, I don't bet the full house. When we launch a product, we can launch all India. We launch it in one state. 7-8 crores investment and see how is it doing. Doing well, then we'll launch it all India. So these are every step we'd like kind of this thing. We do research. We know that otherwise, okay, even 7-8 crores we're putting in, it's not a small money. So we'll say, okay, we'll do a research with about 20-30 lakhs of the product. Okay, it's definitely customer feedback is good. With 500 customers we have checked up. Then we say, okay, it's worth going about doing it. So every stage you mitigate. De-risk yourself.
But doesn't
your competition...
Doesn't it happen in India? Every state is like a country. India is a world in a country.
Yeah, depends so on it. Culturally, culturally very different. We do it in 3-4 centers.
Okay.
So every time you do this, the competition obviously is watching. The competition is watching you closer than you're watching yourself. So while you're testing it, they've seen it. They could throw more money and get after it. You would have lost an opportunity. How would you look at loss of opportunity?
So I think competition may follow suit, but not all the time. Because I started the development much earlier. A product is not just today I develop and kind of tomorrow I'm going to launch. I have been telling you it's a differentiated product. If competition gets to know when I test it and they have to develop, at least it is 1 to 2 years away. So that's the edge we have. It is not easy to just like that launch. In a very hurriedly, I'm very happy. My competition, particularly the multinationals, I take 1 year, they'll take 4 years. So I'm happy that way.
Ramu, the last question.
First question, just out of curiosity, any particular bird you like and the quality or characteristics? Because our friend Rajesh said you have a lot of pets or a lot of birds. That's just a curiosity. The second one is, today, getting vendor credit, in my view or experience, is not as easy. And I'm not sure how someone who starts a business, how can they get vendor credit, you know?
Vendor credit.
Yeah, you said, you know, one of the successes, from what I understand, is that like Walmart, you know, pay after 90 days, pay is agreed, but you collect cash, yeah. Vendor credit. How does somebody who's in a business today that starts in this condition, right, in this economy, how do they get vendor credit?
Okay. I'll tell the easy answer first. I like hyacinth maca because of its color. Very blue, very attractive blue color. Okay. So that's a bird I like. So coming to your this thing, getting money, credit kind of thing is, I told you, you go to people where I go to normal distributors who are well established in the market, they ask me 45 days credit. So I chose small distributors who is ready to get taught about distribution business. I will take in exchange 3,000, 5,000, like that I started initial. Once the product is known, then you are able to attract good quality distributors. And the terms are no change. You have to pay check immediately, it will be presented on dispatch of stocks and it will be this thing. That is how we have done always. So coming to B2B, we have also had a B2B business. So when we are to get a kind of this thing credit from big companies, what we do is, okay, here is the thing, I have to give you 60 days in advance, no problem. I'll give you 60 days credit. But what I do in terms of that, your borrowing rate is about 12%. I get you a bank to fund you at 7.8 or 8%. That is cheaper. You pay me immediately within the next 3-4 days of goods receipt. And all the companies have agreed. So what happens, there is always a vendor credit in the banks, the surplus float fund available in the banks. Many people don't know that. You go and access that fund, it is not coming into in the form of kind of a thing. You don't require to give a security and such kind of things for that. So bankers will give that 20 crores, 30 crores, 50 crores like that. We'll take that, we'll discount, we'll give it to the kind of thing, discount the bill, they will get payment immediately. Kind of thing, they will pay make the payment to the bank on the 60th day or 90th day, the concerned person to whom I have to give credit. But I will realize the payment within 3rd or 4th day of payment. So that way what happens is, whether you have to give 60 days credit also, you will get payment immediately. For them it's a win-win. Instead of paying 12%, they will pay only 8% to the bank.
So the system that you just said is already live and applicable on a platform called cloudbuy.com. What he said, what he must be doing manually, is in an automated format in a platform called cloudbuy.com. So with this, I think we come to an end. Mr. CK, that was wonderful.
Thank you, Mr. Rajesh.
Thanks, Atan. It was very inspiring, very interesting. Mr. Valiappan to come up, please. And I would like to request Sarita Hunt to come up, please, and give a inspiring conversations memento. I'd like to request Lakshmi and Mr. Walter Buthelo to come up, please. Lakshmi and Mr. Walter Buthelo.
You've got a host of mementos.
Walter Buthelo is from Mumbai, one of the largest bus operators in the state of Maharashtra. And he's also the builder for the best buses, BEST. Bharat Coach is the name of the company, and they're one of the largest bus operators in Mumbai and Maharashtra. Thank you, Walter.
Thank you.
I would like to request Rohit and Sunny to come up, please. Sorry, I don't know the people here much. We are all team from Bombay. We are 31 of us who have come in. So you can please give the coffee mug.